Okay, thank you so much, Dr. Uku. I want to thank you and the organizers of the workshop for inviting me for this important two-day workshop. So my topic is on mangroves, and the topic I was given is on environmental stressors and management lessons. So the picture I'm showing there was of a group where we were doing ground truthing for the mangrove management plan in 2014. That was in Ngazi mangrove forest. Next slide, please. So we cannot underestimate the importance of mangroves. We all know their importance. A lot has been said about mangroves, but just allow me to just highlight a few. So mangroves are important because of the many goods and services that we enjoy from them, both the harvestable goods and also the ecosystem services that we derive from mangroves. So for example, we take up wood, fuel wood, there is honey, and many other resources that we harvest from these ecosystems. They are also important for their contribution to offshore fisheries. Although this is still debatable, we cannot wish away the fact that mangroves play a role on the health of offshore fisheries. However, for nearshore mangrove fisheries, this is well documented. There's a lot of research on how, because mangroves support a lot of other fisheries products like crabs, shrimps, bivalves, and this is well documented. Mangroves are also important for coastal protection, where they protect our shorelines from erosion by waves and also other issues of hurricanes and storms. And again, it's a habitat. It has a nursery function for many fishes and also many micro and macro organisms. It has an important role in tourism and contributes a lot of money to our country's GDP. And another important role is on carbon sequestration, because mangroves are active carbon sinks. Yeah, they are really playing a major role in climate change mitigation and also reduction of greenhouse gases in our environment. So another important role of mangroves is on bioprospecting. Although this is still an area that is still has not come up, we have many resources that are there in the mangrove ecosystem, be it the benthic organisms, the bacteria, the fungi that can be harnessed, either the products or the processes for use in biotechnology or for many industrial processes that can that we have. So this is an area, and I'm glad because of the recent conference that we had on the blue economy that was held in Nairobi, regarding how we can utilize marine resources for human need. So and because of this, because of the many threats that mangroves are faced with, so some scientists are wondering, will we be enjoying these mangrove services in the next 100 years? And for example, Duke and other scientists, they were suggesting, how would a world without mangroves be in the next 100 years? So next slide, please. I think we all agree, even from the area presenters, that these ecosystems, the open ocean, the coral reefs, the seagrasses, and the mangrove ecosystem, they are all interconnected. And stressors that affect one ecosystem could relate to another ecosystem. For example, we have the issue of anthropogenic causes. Because of the increased human population, there is increased demand for ocean resources. So human activities, for example, cutting for wood, either wood for construction, wood for fuel, is resulting in a lot of degradation of our mangrove forest, conversion to other land use types. For example, the Lamu Port, construction of hotels, and other human habitation projects, they are all A lot of mangroves are being cut to give room for these developments. There's also the issue of pollution, which maybe will be highlighted later on. And this is about the first presenter talked about microplastics. We also have chemical pollutants from sewage, from and even from our rivers. We recently had a topic, a documentary on the toxic flow of our rivers, how we are emptying all the sewage from Nairobi to our coastal ecosystems. So those are issues that are stressing mangrove ecosystems. And again, we have the issue of climate change. And one aspect of climate change that is likely to affect mangrove ecosystem is sea level rise, because we have that stratification of different mangrove species, those on the landward side and those are on the ocean side. So how are they going to be affected by sea level rise? Yeah, still we have not done enough studies on that. We have issues of ocean acidification. This is mostly highlighted in terms of coral reefs, but how much do we know of how this ocean acidification will also affect mangrove ecosystems? Yeah, a lot of studies also needs to be done. We have issues of hurricanes and storms. Yeah, for example, not only maybe in our country, we have not had a lot of issues on this, but there are countries where hurricanes and storms have really destroyed the mangrove ecosystems. So we cannot rule that out. Issues of temperature rise, and this, for example, is going to affect phenological patterns of mangrove species. How do they produce their propagules and seeds? Because we need seeds for restoration projects. And even the rise in sea surface temperatures, could they also have an effect? For example, maybe in artificial regeneration of propagules. So those are issues that could really stress our mangroves in the near future. We also have issues of governance. Yeah, I'm sure the government has done a lot. We cannot underestimate their role in conservation of mangroves, but we still need a lot on law enforcement, especially on the cutting of mangroves, indiscriminate cutting of mangroves, because again, coastal communities, we cannot prevent them from utilizing resources. Yeah, so as to minimize the conflict use, the resource use conflicts between the local communities and the government and the conservationists, the government still needs to do a lot. There's also the need for monitoring. Yeah, are we monitoring? For example, we came up with a mangrove management plan where we need to enforce the rules: no cutting, maybe no cutting, cut these particular trees. Do we have an effective monitoring of our mangrove forest? Yeah, and also community participation in decision making. Yeah. We want our communities to participate, because we cannot assume that we are the ones who know a lot. Although there has been a lot of community inclusiveness in a lot of conservation issues, but I still believe a lot needs to be done so that they can own up the forests, and therefore we are able to realize a lot of conservation of these mangrove ecosystems. Next, please. So the other point is on the efforts that has been made, efforts for mangroves management in Kenya. Yeah, a lot has been done. A lot has been done, and a lot is still being done. So for example, we have very successful restoration projects of degraded mangrove forests in Kenya. For example, the picture there on the one dated 2014, that's an ecosystem that was initially degraded. The mangroves had been totally cut, but under the restoration projects that was spearheaded by Dr. Cairo, has seen the restoration of that forest to the state that it is now. So again, that was during a ground truthing fieldwork for the mangrove management plan that I was part of. So restoration, what I want to emphasize here is that there has been restoration of degraded mangrove ecosystem. That's a very good and strategic effort. And also the communities have also been sensitized on planting of alternative sources of wood, for example, the casuarina, so that we reduce pressure on the mineral resources of our mangrove forest. So community participation has been enhanced. For example, when I was doing my PhD around 2004, there was very little community participation in mangrove matters. But as we speak now, there has been tremendous and participation and involvement of the community. Then again, you have the mangrove conservation projects. For example, the Mikoko Pamoja project in Ngazi, which is a milestone and has really worked well for mangrove conservation. The development of the mangrove management plan is also another effort for mangrove management and conservation. Also research, a lot of research, and like we have in the seagrasses, a lot of research has been done in mangrove ecosystems regarding the mangrove trees and development of policies, for example, the mangrove management plan. And recently, again, there was the launch of the guidelines on mangrove ecosystem restoration for Western Indian Ocean region, which was spearheaded by WIOMSA and other stakeholders. I also want to highlight the International Blue Economy Conference that was held in Nairobi, because it brings awareness even to people who may not have an idea. For example, I could hear many people asking, what is this blue economy? Yeah. So that highlighting and bringing awareness to even the local person who does not know whether they are mangroves or they are not, it is a very important step in mangrove conservation. And again, we are also in the process of inclusion of mangroves in the Kenyan nationally determined contribution. So for example, we are aiming at reducing 30% reduction of greenhouse gases in our environment by 2030. Yeah, business as usual while we continue utilizing mangroves and all that. And again, we know mangroves are very important in terms of carbon sequestration, in terms of the many ecosystem services that we derive from mangroves. Yet they have not been included in the NDCs. But I'm glad that this process is ongoing, and soon mangroves will be incorporated in the national. In the NDC strategic plan for our country. Next, please. Sorry, just before you just go back to that, please. There's also that article that is in press that is talking on about fishers who rely on mangroves, monitoring and mapping of global, I cannot read well, of global mangroves associated fisheries. This shows that mangrove associated fisheries are important. First of all, because fishermen who engage in mangrove fisheries are the small artisanal and subsistence fishermen, and they form the majority, and then they support larger coastal communities. So this paper, I believe it's going to highlight and to map the resources within the mangrove ecosystem, the fisheries products. And I can see our very own Cosmas Munga is involved in that lighter. And in the other photo, I'm showing the community participation. This was during a project in Lamu for the national determined contributions. So again, just highlighting the need for community participation, because for that meeting, the community in Lamu was greatly involved in that workshop. And it was a good sign of where we are headed. Next, please. So what are these key lessons that we have learned in the management of these pressures on mangroves? First of all, as we carry out those conservation and management issues, we have realized that there is a need for national recognition on the importance of mangroves. Not that we don't know, but we cannot forget to continue emphasizing, yeah, because of the rise in population, the pressure continues. Yeah. So the government, the communities, the stakeholders must all be informed. And again, you are saying governance issues are very key. And I'm glad the government is taking the lead, the ministry, the State Department of Fisheries. Yeah. They are taking the lead in conservation management, in mangrove conservation issues. Yeah, for example, they'll be involved in policy development, inclusion of mangroves in NDCs, law enforcement. They are going to encourage community participation. Remember, they can fund community participation through our county governments. So government plays a key role. It plays a key role and drives the conservation of mangrove ecosystems. There is need for more continued research, training, and knowledge dissemination is very important, because we need to form, to develop policies that are guided by scientific research. Yeah. So we cannot underestimate the need for research, training new upcoming scientists, and knowledge dissemination. Let our knowledge not just remain on the shelves. Yeah. Let us develop policies. You know, when you do a policy document, it needs to be understood by the even local community. They can read and understand. You translate your scientific knowledge to what the locals can understand. Yeah. So we are able to make decisions regarding mangrove ecosystem. So, for example, we have had a lot of work on carbon sequestration. So that work is going to inform the inclusion of mangroves in the NDCs. And I'm glad also WIOMSA has been part of this. It has funded many masters and PhD projects on research and training. Then a lot has been talked about the integrated coastal management of coastal resources, where we need interaction of stakeholders to reduce conflicts. That has been emphasized by the area speakers. So we cannot wish away collaboration between the various stakeholders, various scientists from the different ecosystems, the blue carbon ecosystem, so that we can have a plan for conservation of coastal ecosystem. So we cannot separate mangroves from seagrasses, mangroves from corals, or mangroves from the open ocean. They are all related. Then there's the need for resource mapping. Yeah. A lot has been done and a lot is still remaining. We cannot conserve what we do not know. Yeah, a lot has been done on coral reefs, mangroves, maybe the open ocean. What about the seagrasses, like Ririan has said? What about in the mangrove ecosystems? We have the benthic community, we have the bacteria, we have the fungi. I'm sorry, I'm bringing this up. I'm also a microbiologist, and I felt we also need to understand what happens in those benthic and the sediments, because they play a role in the health of our ecosystems, and therefore we can also not leave them out. And then again, something that also comes out is that we need to campaign, as much as there's also a lot of uptake of these mangrove trees, we need to campaign more for reduced deforestation and increased restoration. Yeah, because deforestation, for example, is instant. We can destroy a very huge forest within a very short time. But how long does it take for that forest to recover? For example, Dr. David said that to recover coral reef ecosystems, it takes more than 20 years. The same things the same thing happens with the mangrove ecosystems. We can destroy very quickly, but for that forest to recover, it will take ages. So we need to campaign more for reduced deforestation and increased restoration, not only of degraded forest, but also planting where mangroves can survive and maybe they are not there. Of course, there are many other issues that come and play a role, right, in the reforestation of forest. But it's good to increase our forest cover, whichever way possible that we can be able to do that. Next, please. And again, my last slide is on my marine spatial planning, consideration for mangrove management. So what is this marine spatial planning going to, what can they consider as they draft their management plan? What are these lessons from mangrove management that they can also incorporate as they, in this process going forward? So again, the same issues. Have an all-inclusive process, and I'm glad this meeting it looks inclusive from the point of view of all the scientists from the various ecosystems, and even those who are in attendance of the meeting. I'm sure they all have what they can offer in this MSP process. So this is a good indication, and it's a good way. It's a good thing going forward. Inclusiveness reduces conflicts, as was highlighted earlier. Resource mapping is important. Let us map what we have so that we know what is out there, for the local communities to utilize, because we do not want those conflicts. For example, we are saying mangrove fishery products is dominated by subsistence and artisanal commercial fishers. Remember, these are going to be greatly affected. Yeah, they are going to be greatly affected by the management plan that will come up, because sometimes they'll be told don't harvest this product at this time, you know, and then they're the majority of the people who utilize these resources within the mangrove ecosystem. So let us map our resources so that they are able to be used sustainably. Then there's need for a species specific consideration in the MSP. And species, when I talk about species specific within the mangrove ecosystem, we all know that the local communities have a preference for certain mangrove species to meet their certain needs. For example, the wood for construction. For example, Lysophora mucronata is a species that is highly preferred by the local people. Yet, this species has characteristic growth behavioral patterns in terms of growth, in terms of propagule development. Yeah. So all the species do not behave the same, and therefore we cannot have a blanket conservation plan for all of them. We need species specific. Yeah. For example, I saw for propagules, they take very long for them to mature, as opposed to Avicennia marina. So we need to have a plan that caters for the different species. Yeah, so that we do not end up utilizing all the species that are preferred by the local communities. Yeah, what will be left for our future generations and even for our own utilization. Again, we need to map for non-fisheries products. Yeah, microorganisms, we can harness them for antibiotics, for antiviral compounds, for what? But there's a lack of data for most of these resources. The benthic fauna, there's a lot of harvesting for bait harvesting for fisheries. Yeah. Are we looking at a scenario where we could they could be extinct? Like we are talking of a red list. Could this benthic fauna also be extinct at a particular point? They have a role that they play in the ecosystem, within the food chain, within the food webs, within the health of the ecosystem. So we also need to map that. And then we emphasize the need for reduced and controlled cutting, yeah, and the need for embracing alternative livelihood sources to meet community needs in the MSP plan. And then we also need to emphasize and campaign for effective governance. We cannot underestimate the power of effective governance from our government, law enforcement, community policing of mangrove areas. For example, I'm suggesting here that licensed mangrove cutters should be local. Hmm? Let's not having mangrove cutters coming from Kilifi to Kwale, because if they keep being mobile, yeah, they need to be where they belong so that they can be able to form part of the conservation group in that area. So that if they exhaust their resources, there will be nowhere else to run to. Yeah, and that will be a mileage in the conservation of our mangrove ecosystems. Okay, next, I think that was the last one. And thank you so much for your time. And thank you.